Imagine looking through a lens that warps and shifts light as you move, quite blurry, distorted, and unpredictable. That's what life can look like for someone with advanced keratoconus. Hello and welcome to Inside Ophthalmology. I am Dr. Amrit and I welcome you to another lecture. Today we are diving into one of the most fascinating and clinically significant corneal ectasias, and that is keratoconus. In this session, we shall explore about the associated systemic and ocular conditions with keratoconus, the clinical signs and symptoms of keratoconus, and more importantly, why those signs appear the way they do. So this is not just a surface level overview. We are going deep into the science and clinical relevance, so stay with us till the end. Previously, we discussed corneal ectasia, which is a non-inflammatory, progressive, thinning, and outward bulging of the cornea. Today, we are zeroing in on keratoconus, a form of ectasia where the cornea takes on a conical shape, distorting vision in a unique and complex way. Also, don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already so you never miss an update from Inside Ophthalmology. Next up, let's talk about the epidemiology of keratoconus, how common it is, and which populations are more likely to be affected. The prevalence of keratoconus varies widely from as low as 0.05% to as high as 5%. This variation largely depends upon the population being studied. Keratoconus is about 4 times more common in Asian population. Not only is the disease more prevalent, but also it tends to appear earlier and present more severely in these groups. Studies show that keratoconus is more prevalent in hot, sunny climates, especially in parts of Asia, Middle East, India, and Australia. In contrast, Western countries like United States and part of Europe report lower prevalence rates. While genetics do play a role, environmental triggers like chronic UV exposure and eye rubbing may contribute to this geographical pattern. About the age of onset, keratoconus typically presents during the early teenage years, with the average age of onset being around 15.4 years plus or minus 4 years. An important clinical nugget to be noted over here is that younger patients require closer follow-up since they are more likely to show rapid progression. It means that in adults, when the follow-up interval is about 6 months to 1 year, in case of children or pediatric keratoconic patients, the follow-up interval would be about 3 months to 6 months. In the last decade, however, both the incidence and prevalence of keratoconus have been on the rise, with the average age of diagnosis also trending younger, the youngest being as young as 4-year-old, especially with a strong family history and risk factors. The disease is more common in males compared to females. Now let's talk about the etiology and the risk factors of keratoconus. In our previous video, we explored the intricate pathophysiology of corneal ectasias, diving deep into the complex interplay of genetic predisposition, hereditary pattern, environmental influences, and biomechanical failure. The very same principles are at play in keratoconus as well. So if you haven't already watched that video, I strongly recommend checking it out. You'll find the link right in the description box below and in the I button at the top right corner of your screen. Let's talk about the genetic predisposition in keratoconus. For a long time, keratoconus was considered mostly sporadic, with only about 10% of the cases thought to have a familial link. But emerging research tells a different story. Newer evidence suggests that familial prevalence is significantly higher than previously believed, pointing towards a much stronger genetic component. In many affected families, the pattern of inheritance appears to be autosomal dominant, but with a twist, variable penetrance. That means not everyone who inherits the gene will actually develop the disease, or they might express it in a different degree of severity. So, if someone in the family has keratoconus, especially a first-degree relative, the rest of the family may be at a higher risk, even if they don't show obvious signs. This reinforces the importance of screening family members, especially before procedures like refractive surgeries, where undiagnosed keratoconus or a predisposition could lead to complications like ectasias. Now let's talk about the keratoconus and its associations. Keratoconus could be associated with ocular disorders, systemic disorders, and the genetic disorders. Under the ocular associations, we see conditions like Leber's congenital amaurosis, Vernal's keratoconjunctivitis, floppy iris syndrome, retinitis pigmentosa, retinopathy of prematurity, and aniridia. Systemically, atopic diseases such as eczema, asthma, hay fever, they are common. And under the connective tissue disorders, we can have Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, Marfan syndrome, and osteogenesis imperfecta. Also, keratoconus could be associated with genetic disorders as well, like Down syndrome, Crouzon syndrome, Apert syndrome, neurofibromatosis, and even Turner's syndrome. Next, moving on, let's discuss the clinical features of the keratoconus. Whenever we are discussing the clinical features, we have to talk about the symptoms that the patient presents with and the signs which we elicit on examination. Under the symptoms, first we should know that the keratoconus is usually a bilateral condition, but it's often asymmetric, meaning one eye may get more affected than the other. A hallmark feature is progressive, irregular astigmatism, which leads to a steady decline in distant visual acuity. Also, there is a need for frequent changes in glass prescription. These changes are often the first clues for early diagnosis. Patients with keratoconus often report a range of visual disturbances beyond blurry vision. These include glare, halos, especially at night, ghost images, and monocular polyopia, where multiple images are seen with one eye. They may also develop poor tolerance to contact lenses, especially as the corneal shape becomes more irregular over time. An important clinical nugget to remember over here is that the symptoms of keratoconus are worse at night because at night the pupil dilates and the light now will enter through the inferior or the paracentral cone of the cornea, causing problems like glare. Moving on, we have the signs which can be seen in keratoconus, and they can be divided into the external signs, slit lamp signs, ophthalmoscopic or retinoscopic signs, and other signs. Keratoconus can present with some classical external signs that can aid in diagnosis. The first one is the Munson's or the Munson sign, in which we have a V-shaped indentation of the lower eyelid seen in the down gaze, caused by the conical protrusion of the cornea. This is a non-specific finding and often a late finding. Usually, the diagnosis of the disease is made long before the Munson sign is evident. Next on the list is the Rizzuti sign. The Rizzuti sign appears when the light is shown from the temporal part of the limbus, and now you will notice a sharp reflection on the nasal limbus due to the conical shape of the cornea. The reflection itself is of a conical shape. This occurs because the apex of the conical cornea focuses the light sharply onto the opposite limbal area, and this is known as the Rizzuti sign. Next, we shall be looking at the slit lamp signs that can help us diagnose keratoconus clinically. An eccentrically located ectatic protrusion of the cornea is noted. While the cone apex is most often situated inferior to an imaginary horizontal line drawn through the pupillary axis, in some cases it might also be located centrally. We might see two types of cones, a nipple or a smaller shaped cone, and also a larger oval or sagging cone. The larger cone may extend from one limbus to the another, and these are the cases who are more prone to contact lens fitting problems. Next, we have the presence of the Fleischer or the Fleischer's ring. This is a circular or a semicircular ring seen at the base of the cone caused by hemosiderin deposition. It is best appreciated under a cobalt blue filter, especially in subtle cases, and it helps us to estimate even the extent of the cone. You might ask, why does the Fleischer ring form? As the cornea becomes conical in keratoconus, the curvature becomes abnormal. This changes how the tear film spreads across the cornea, especially around the steeper cone. These altered tear dynamics can cause iron from the tear film, specifically the ferric ions, to deposit more in this region. At the same time, the epithelial cells at the base of the cone will now show increased turnover. These cells start absorbing and storing this iron as hemosiderin. Over time, this iron pigment
will build up into a pigmented arc or a complete ring, what we clinically identify as the Fleischer's ring. This is best seen with a cobalt blue filter. Next, we are going to talk about how it appears on the Pearl's Prussian blue staining. Hemosiderin is an iron storage pigment, and under a routine HNE stain, it shows up as a golden yellow to brown coarse granules, typically seen within the cytoplasm of the basal cells or the macrophages. But to confirm the presence of iron, we need to use special stain, and these are the Pearl's Prussian blue. In this reaction, the ferric ion in the hemosiderin reacts with the potassium ferrocyanide present within the Pearl's Prussian blue, and it forms the ferric ferrocyanide, which appears as a deep blue granule. So when you see a blue staining granule in the basal layer using the Pearl stain, you are looking at the hemosiderin deposition. Moving on to the next slit lamp finding, and that is the stromal thinning. The cornea becomes progressively thinner, typically in the inferotemporal quadrant, correlating with the location of the cone. The thinness may vary from 1/2 to 1/5 of the normal thickness, and it is observed at the apex of the protrusion. A very important and favorite of examiners is the Vogt striae. These are vertical stress lines seen in the posterior stroma in the area of the cone. An important diagnostic clue here is that they will disappear with gentle pressure on the globe. They are not seen in the Descemet's membrane. Okay, so you have to remember that the Vogt striae are seen in the posterior stroma and not in the Descemet's membrane. In advanced cases of keratoconus, we can see scarring as well. And this could be either at the level of the basement membrane, epithelium, or the anterior stroma, or in the Descemet's membrane. We are all aware of the Descemet membrane tears in keratoconus leading to high drops, but what is less known is a basement membrane tears. These basement membrane tears can lead to posterior growth of the epithelium into the Bowman's layer or the anterior growth of the collagen from the stroma to the epithelium, leading to formation of the reticular, subepithelial or anterior stromal scars shown by the number 1 over here. Less commonly, what is seen in high drops is a Descemet level scarring. First of all, let's try to understand what is a corneal high drops. A corneal high drops is an acute dramatic event that occurs when there are ruptures in the Descemet membrane. These ruptures will permit the aqueous humor from the anterior chamber to suddenly enter the corneal stroma, leading to intense stromal imbibition of the fluid. As a result, the cornea becomes markedly edematous and patient experiences sudden pain, blurred vision, photophobia and often tearing. Clinically, the cornea appears hazy, swollen, thickened as seen here in the slit lamp photo. Also, sometimes we can also find these intrastromal fluid-filled clefts, and minor trauma in these cases can cause corneal rupture in a case of high drops. But here's the good news. Over the course of several weeks to months, the break in the Descemet membrane gradually heals on its own and the cornea begins to clear up. However, even after resolution, the stromal scarring is often left behind and this scar tissue might be present in the periphery or in the center. If it is dense and central, it can cause significant visual impairment. If the corneal edema persists beyond a few months, or if the resultant scar is visually significant, especially if it's central, then penetrating keratoplasty may be required to restore vision in these patients. Last but not the least is the prominent corneal nerves seen on the slit lamp. These are very subjective and mild localized findings that could be seen in a case of keratoconus. You might see more visible and tortuous nerves in the area of stromal thinning in keratoconus. However, this is a non-specific sign. Moving on, we have the ophthalmoscopic or the retinoscopic signs associated with keratoconus, and the first one is seen on ophthalmoscopy. This is known as the oil droplet sign or the Charleux sign. Usually on direct ophthalmoscopy, you are going to see a red reflex. However, in case of a keratoconus, we will find a central dark shadow surrounded by a bright reflex. This is known as an oil droplet sign. Why does it happen? Well, It's caused by the conical protrusion or irregular curvature of the cornea in keratoconus. This abnormal curvature acts like a high-powered minus lens that diverges the light rays, producing a central dark shadow surrounded by a relatively brighter reflex, similar to how an oil droplet might look on water. Next, we have reflex. It refers to the movement of the retinoscopic reflex in opposite directions when you are carrying out the retinoscopy. It often resembles the opening and closing up of a scissor. Why does scissoring happen in keratoconus? It could be because of the irregular corneal curvature, multiple focal points, or the reflex disruption. In keratoconus, the cornea becomes conical, and therefore the meridians of curvature are also not perpendicular or uniform. Moreover, due to the uneven surface, light rays entering the eye are refracted unevenly. Also, when you notice the reflex, the streak or the reflex behaves erratically. In one meridian, you may see a with movement and in the other, an against movement. And therefore, this is known as a scissoring reflex. This brings us to an important clinical nugget. The earliest sign of keratoconus seen is the scissoring reflex on retinoscopy. And when you are asked about the earliest sign of keratoconus on slit lamp, that is the Fleischer's ring. Also, while examining a case of keratoconus, don't forget to also look for signs of ocular allergy. Things like papillae, conjunctival pigmentation, and even a gerontoxin. These may be subtle, but they matter. We already covered vernal keratoconjunctivitis in detail in another video on our channel. If you haven't watched that yet, do check it out. The link is in the description below and also in the I button on the top right corner of your screen. That wraps up our discussion on the clinical signs and features of keratoconus. I hope you found it useful and easy to understand. If you did, don't forget to subscribe and click on the bell icon so you never miss an update, especially as we continue to explore more on keratoconus in upcoming videos. Thank you and have a nice day.